Tonight, we have somebody special with us in the house. He's a man who has an amazing story of how God literally called him out of a place of darkness to use to spread the gospel all throughout the world. This is a man who's seen miracles flowing, a man who travels the world preaching the gospel all over the world, and he's here with us tonight. Church, I want us to get ready. Someone say, get ready. Get ready to receive all that God has for you. And can we please give a big Way World Outreach welcome to Evangelist Wynne Goss tonight? Can we give a big Way World Outreach welcome to him? A man of God tonight coming ready to preach the word.
Good evening. There is something special happening in the spirit right now. Just today, just a few hours on our way up here, Gwenda and I and some of our dear friends and spiritual daughters, Sandy and Marla, were in Alabama last weekend. And a lady was brought. She never goes to church, but she was brought because somebody went, led of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit said, go and invite that lady to the meetings. And this lady said, I'll come as long as someone will pray for me. And he said, why? What's the matter with you? And she said, I've just been given a terminal prognosis. My liver is failing. I have weeks to live. So he brought her to us at the end of a meeting and told me the story. And we just said, you know, Jesus doesn't take any notice of the natural whatsoever. You know, if Jesus is not afraid of the devil, nor are you. If Jesus is not afraid of cancer, nor should you be. If Jesus is not afraid of the sickness, disease, and the prognosis, nor should we. And I just comforted that lady and just reminded her, he is the Lord of all glory. And we laid hands on her, rebuked that thing, and we just declared to her, you will go back to the doctor. The surgeon will declare you totally free, that there will be no evidence. Today, that notice came. She is totally healed, totally free. And I believe tonight, even while we're in this building, while we're here, you may be sitting under the word, under the worship. I'm telling you, the healing anointing, the delivering anointing, the breakthrough anointing, the whatever anointing it is that you need, he is here. His name is Holy Spirit. And he is right here to minister to you if you receive it. So I can remember in Poland, well, you may be seated a moment. Thank you. But you know, if I say anything good, you can shout amen. Because I pastored a church, and that's why I used to say to them, the only thing that's silent in heaven, in creation, is the grave. Everything else has a voice. And it's supposed to say amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah, glory to God. It's supposed to acknowledge God. So if I preach anything good tonight, you can shout amen. If I preach something that really speaks into your life, you can stand up, wave a handkerchief or something and say, glory to God. If I give the prophetic word or the Lord uses me to speak the prophetic word right into your life, you can slap the person either side of you and say, my God, my God. If it gets better than that, get up and throw your wallet or your purse down here as your offering. I said to Poland, I didn't mean Poland, I meant Czechoslovakia. Just after the Berlin Wall came down, we were right in. Within weeks of the wall coming down, we were in Czechoslovakia holding missions. And I remember being on a stage in a concert hall filled with about, I don't know, 500 or 600 people. And through an interpreter, I began to preach the gospel and I truly preach all the time about the identity of Jesus in you. And who you are in him and who he is in you. And I was preaching that Jesus cannot not be miraculous. His life is simply miraculous. And if his life is miraculous and you're born again, then the life of God in you is miraculous. Oh, thank you for that underwhelming response. There is no difference to the life in Jesus and the life of Jesus in you. It's identical. It's exactly the same. It can't fade. It can't go weak. It can't stop because you're black or you're white or you're Mexican or you're Philistine or you're Welsh or you're English. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't matter how old or young you are. It doesn't matter how educated or uneducated. I'm telling you, this person right here in front of you was uneducated. I didn't like it. And yet, in my first year of salvation, 220 people got saved, and all every miracle conceivable began to happen. Because simply, I read my New Testament and thought Jesus wanted me to do what he did. It works. So I was preaching this in Czechoslovakia, and suddenly over there in the corner, there was this, a lot of movement and things were going, and people jumping up and down and shouting in their language, and I didn't know what was happening. So we asked them, what's happening? And a woman came in on a stretcher from a hospital. They brought her from the hospital and into the meeting to sit in the presence of Jesus. And she was lying on the stretcher. And when I began ministering, I said, and don't wait to the end to get prayed for. If you're sick now, then ask for the Lord for the miracle to happen right now where you're sitting. So she did. And the Lord healed her. She was paralyzed. She jumped up off that stretcher and started running around the building. Jesus operates when there's faith. Well, don't use your faith at the end. Use it at the beginning. Just a thought. Just a thought. I am so honored and delighted to be with you. Gwenda, stand up so they can see how beautiful you are. That's my dear wife, Gwenda. We've heard about you. We've heard about you. Your name goes everywhere. And I've never heard a bad word about you. I've heard great words about you. The great things that Jesus is doing and the great things that Pastor Marco has done over the years and how this is built up and how it's just growing and growing and growing. And I'm so delighted, you know, Jerry and Julia, old friends of ours. I don't mean they're old. I just mean they're old friends. We just had a great relationship, and they just began to tell us about you as soon as they came here. And so it's taken us 4 years to get here to come and minister, but we're delighted today. And if Pastor Marco is listening and or watching at any point, we just want to thank you so much for the honor to stand behind this pulpit. We honor you. We honor the Lord in you. We honor the vision, and we pray for it, and we know it will extend. So are you ready for tonight's word? Well, you'll have to endure the advert first. I have three books out in wherever we are. Is it out that way? We have three back that way, out in the reception. You'll see Sandy and Marla standing by a book table, and they've got their own book out there called Intentional Intimacy. But I want to show you three books. You can only get one tonight because that's the only one that's here. But and I'm not sure how many is there, but it's probably the first 20, 30 people will get it. So you might have to stampede all over somebody to get it. It's a trilogy of books. I'm gonna try and do this. I haven't got three hands. So this book is Don't Kick the Donkey, Ride It. I work hard at the titles to make sure that they're memorable. Don't Kick the Donkey, Ride It. An Old Testament prophet kicked his donkey that God was trying to use to get him from where he needed to be. Jesus climbed on his donkey and rode it to destiny. This book is about how God prepares you for the greatest events in your life. If you will just stay in faith and stop doubting when everything goes against you, if you just begin to doubt your doubts and keep fast to the Word of God, the Word of God will come to your rescue and deliver you. It will pick you up like a donkey and carry you over the mountain of adversity. Remember, Jesus rode a donkey over the mountain. The donkey is those circumstances that look bad. But God never has bad circumstances for you. He turns all bad circumstances into good ones. He works all things together for good, for those who are called to His purposes. And this book is about how God turned my world upside down in just 3 years. My mother, my father, and my wife were the three greatest relationships I had. And one day, my father, it's a long story, it's told in here, but after a remarkable reconciliation with him, he died. He had a miracle. He was raised from the dead, but he had a miracle and lived another 14 years, and we were the best, closest friends and father and son relationship. But he died. And then the following year, 10 months, 11 months later, my mother came home from vacation and said, I don't want to do it ever again on my own. I want to be in heaven with your father. And a few days later, she was gone. Another 10 to 11 months later, my wife, Anne, who had been battling cancer for 8.5 years, died and went to be with the Lord. And right at that moment, the Lord said to me, in one moment, everything will turn around. And I thought that was a message. I thought that was maybe a title of a book, but it wasn't. It was what God was about to do in my life. He was about to turn my world upside down, inside out, right way up. He was about to explode my ministry. He was about to do some remarkable things in my life, and He will do it for you. But this book is about preparation, how God spent thousands of years to prepare Israel for the greatest event. The second book is Alignment for Assignment. The first book goes up as far as the cross, but the second book goes from the cross onwards. You see, the one who went into the tomb is not the one who came out. Excuse me. I'm going to preach it tonight. Jesus of Nazareth went in, but the Lord of all glory came out. Jesus in the natural flesh went in, but Jesus with the eternal body, the one that never fades, came out. The one who went in was limited by his body, but the one who came out, there was nothing that could keep him down. There was nothing that could stop him going up. There was nothing that could keep him out, and there was nothing that could keep him in. He walked through the walls. He broke every barrier. He destroyed every natural human resistance and said he was the Lord of all glory. You were not born again after the one who went in. You're born again after the one who came out. You don't have the nature of Jesus of Nazareth. You have the nature of the Lord of all glory. You have the nature of the Alpha, Omega, the Lion of Judah, the beginning and the end. You have the nature of the one who speaks all things into being and holds it by the palm of his hands. He has the nature that destroyed the power of sin and death, and that nature resides in you. No sin or death can hold you. My Lord. Woo. It's hot up here. The third book, Achieving Heaven's Vision for Your Life. Pressing the reset button on the way we do church. I don't know, you know, some people have a real problem with that message. They've wrote to me about it. They've spoken to me face to face. They've phoned me. They've emailed me. Because I say remarkable, honest things. You won't find the church of today anywhere in the New Testament. You won't find the model of church that we have today on a normal basis. You won't find it in the New Testament. Jesus didn't tell anybody to build him a church. He said he was going to build the church. We're supposed to extend the kingdom of God. Amen. And God has a vision, a purpose for every single person here tonight. It is to duplicate yourself. It is to destroy the works of darkness, because Jesus isn't coming back to do it. He has sent you to do it. He has empowered you with all power, all authority over all the works of the devil. And he sent you. Amen. Woo, turn to the person alongside you and say, are you saved yet? I'd like you to turn. I'm going to show you. I'd like you, if you would, turn with me, Acts chapter 1. I want to first just say something that may offend somebody in here. I don't know. I don't ever mean to offend. I just do. It's the gift of an apostle. That's what they do. They just knock the doors down. They just destroy our concepts and challenge us to get right in alignment with the Word of God. And that's all I do. I'm sorry. I actually believe in climate change. And I believe it's our job to change the climate. I believe it's our job to turn sickness into health, fear into love, condemnation into righteousness. I believe it's to turn from darkness to light. I believe from despair to hope. You are to change the climate wherever you are, wherever you go. That's why you're on the planet. Can I just ask you, if you have no intention of doing that, go home to be with Jesus now. Because the only reason you're here is to finish what he started. He started a movement. He started a message. He started something that the world had never known. Nobody had ever said, all power and all authority has been given unto me. No one, no prophet, no philosopher, no person in the past had ever been able to say that. But when Jesus rose from the dead, he had been given all power, all authority. And he said, now, go in my name. And if he changed the world, the known world, through 120 people in an upper room, imagine what can happen in California. Imagine what can happen in California. Hello? In John 19, this is the opening to the message. In John 19, from verse 42 into John 20, if you take out something like a New King James Bible, you will find that Luke, when he's writing, John, when he's writing that, uses the same sort of statement. He uses the word takeaway. And he's referring to how the body of Jesus was taken away. But he says it 8 times. Now, I grew up in a Bible school with a teacher that taught me something about numbers. And he said, when you see those lists of numbers in Deuteronomy and Leviticus and all those things, and he said, what do you and everybody else do? I said, we probably just all look at them, turn the page over. He said, that's right, but it's as much God's word as Psalm 23. It's as much God's word as John 3:16. You see, God speaks in numbers. God speaks in colors. God speaks in shapes. He speaks in every single way. And if all we do is read the English or whatever language we're reading it in, then we're narrowing down what God can say. So when God, he said to me, when God says something once, Wynne, it's important, because God doesn't have anything else to say. He's important every time he speaks. If he says the same thing twice in a passage, he's speaking and trying to get your attention. If he says it three times, he's screaming from the rooftop saying, wake up, wake up. Well, imagine what he's saying if he says it eight times in one chapter. And it's because it's crucial for us to understand that when Jesus went to the cross, he took your sin. He took your sin nature. Not your sins, your sin nature. He took the whole volume of all persons' sin nature from Adam until Jesus returns and it's all over. He took the whole volume of sin and death. He took the whole volume of the sin nature and said, put it on me. And put it on him. And when the Father put it on him, it distorted his body. And then he was crucified, shed his blood all over it, went to the grave, shook it off, and walked out in a resurrection life. And you never, ever see that body again. Because when they went in the tomb, it was gone. And they passed a living Jesus to visit the dead one because he didn't look like Jesus. And when they went in the tomb, the first thing Mary said is to the gardener, she thought he was the gardener, please tell me where they've taken him to and I will fetch him back. God doesn't want it back. He took it as far away from you as is possible. He threw it from the east to the west and remembers it no more. You are not a sinner trying to become a saint. You are a saint. You are a saint by the power of the blood of Jesus. You're not a saint by anything that you do. Imputed into you is the very nature of righteousness of God. I can see some of you not quite convinced. Acts 1:9-11. Now when he had spoken these things while they watched, he was taken and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, men of Galilee, why do you stand up gazing into heaven? Well, that's a stupid question. What would you be doing? Imagine Pastor Marco next Sunday at the end of the service saying, I love you all, God bless, and what would you do? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I love it when he does that. That's so cute. I don't think you'd be doing that. I think your jaw would be down to your knees. And I think you'd be straining your eye to watch him go further and further and further. And you're gone. You're so concentrating on what's leaving, you've not even noticed what's arrived. And too many Christians are so concerned about their past, you can't even see what he's given you. He's wiped away every stain. He's wiped away every mark. If you could go to heaven right now and stand before him and Satan was there and Satan had the book and opened it because he wanted to accuse you and show you what you were like, every page was blank. Why? Because there is no evidence of it. It's not as if you never sinned. God has given you back and a nature that never sinned. It's perfect. Why am I laboring this? Because until you know who you really are in Christ, you will never believe the power of Christ that can flow through you. Because God didn't save you so you could go to church. He didn't save you so you could go to heaven. He didn't save you so you don't go to hell. That's really selfish. When Jesus went to John the Baptist, he stood in the waters and John saw him and said, no. I have need of you baptizing me, not me baptizing you. And Jesus answered a statement that tells you the whole purpose of Jesus' ministry. He looked at John and said, yes, I know, but do it to fulfill righteousness. The whole purpose of Jesus is not to save you. That's a part of it. The purpose of Jesus is to restore righteousness back in every area of your life. Righteousness is the nature of Jesus. Righteousness is the right standing of God. In other words, that when Adam had never sinned, there was righteousness. Everything in the garden was in an order of righteousness. When Adam sinned, it was gone. And sin has marred creation. It's marred the whole of the planet. It's marred everything about us. But when Jesus saved you, he restored your spirit, your soul, your body, your mind, your finances, your family, everything about your future. He did it even into your past, and he restored righteousness in the past, the present, and your future. You are righteous beyond measure. You are so righteous that God says, you know what? Father, Son, and Holy Ghost will come and live in you. You know, when you walk into a city or you walk into a room, if you know who you are, you'll know a truth. Every demon in the vicinity will flee. Any demon inside a person begins to panic. Why? Because when you know who you are, you're not afraid of the devil, he's afraid of you. You're not afraid of the demons, they're afraid of you. Sickness is not as afraid of you. I'm telling you, darkness. Oh God. Woo. When you go home tonight, will it be dark? When you go to your house and there's no lights on, do you flick a switch on? Yeah? Do you stand at the door for 15 minutes while light and darkness argue? And then all of a sudden, light just about wins. Darkness is simply the absence of light. So turn the light on. I'm going to preach this way. Maybe the walls will cry out. Great message, Wynne. Great message. Turn the light on. Just turn the light on and the darkness is gone. The darkness exists because the church hasn't turned its light on. It's hiding it in buildings. It's hiding it in systems. It's hiding it under a cloak of religion. It's hiding it under a cloak of, I'm having to do something to be better so Jesus can use me. Turn the light on. Have some faith. Have some guts in the faith. Believe what he says is absolutely true. He cannot lie to you. He can't lie at all. If he said you have power and authority over all the works of the devil, you do. So just accept it. Wow. Let's go back to that scripture. Men of Galilee, why do you stand up gazing into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Now, I don't know what translation you're looking at, but on the screen I'm imagining it's the New King James. It says, this same Jesus. But the word same in your Bible is in italics. It means it's not there. But the translators wanted to give us the understanding of what the Greek words actually are trying to communicate. Not this Jesus, but this same Jesus will return. The emphasis isn't the mode of transport, the cloud. And we have so many Christians who are waiting for Jesus to come in the cloud. And they'll fight and they'll argue and they'll do Bible studies and look at all sorts of things about Jesus going in the clouds and coming back in the clouds. The problem is the message is not about the clouds. The message, the emphasis, is about this same Jesus. Why? Is there two? Yeah. One who went in and one who came out. The one who comes out is the one that's the Lord of all glory. He is the Alpha Omega. He is the living Son of God. He is the one that ascended, and the angel said to the disciples, he, this one, is coming back. It's not a different one. It's this one. But it tells us in 1 John that when every eye sees him and we, the church, behold him, we will suddenly look at him, look at one another, look at him, look at one another and say, my God, we're just like him. We are like him now, not in heaven, now. He wants a company of people who understand they are just like him now on this earth, not when you get to heaven, on this earth. Yeah, whoa, was right. I'm running out of time already. No. I'm gonna be good. The girls will tell you I can be really naughty and really stretch it. But tonight, I want to be good, because short messages always get invited back. Mark 16:12 says this statement. I'm going to read this to you, and we're going to look at it. I read this, I don't know, hundreds of times, just like you read your Bible hundreds and hundreds of times. That's because I'm speaking in faith. If you don't read your Bible and you don't have a love of reading your Bible, you need to get saved all over again. Nothing in life is achieved apart by Jesus, because he is the life and he is the word. Therefore, the word is the life to your spirit. The word is the life to your soul. It's the life. It's a medicine. It's the life of God to your body, to every part of your being. So you should find a hunger. And if you don't have one, ask him to give you one, because it should be the most natural thing in the world for us to devour to the word of God, just to love it. But I read this statement, I don't know, I read this passage 100 times, and I had never seen this one statement the way I did one morning at 11 o'clock with my cup of coffee. I was reading the book of John, reading the book of Mark, and I turned over the page and I read this statement. And I nearly dropped my cup as I read it. I'd never heard anybody preach it. I can tell you to this day, I still haven't heard anybody preach it except me. I'm not saying they haven't. I've never heard it. I have never known of anybody tell me it's been written in somebody else's book. This is the only thing I know, is that this is what happened to me. I didn't read it in a book somewhere. It happened to me, and I was staggered, and it took me 4 years before I had the courage to preach it. But I asked every big ministry that I knew, and I knew some great theological people, and I asked them and said, what does that mean? Is that meaning what I think it is? And they looked at me and said, yes. And I said, have you preached it? No. Why not? Too controversial. Look what it says. After that, he appeared in another form. Do we need to go any further? After that, he appeared in another form to two of them as they walked, and they went into the country. He appeared in another form. When I read that, I thought, nah, that can't mean what I think it does. So I got out my Greek concordance. I got my lexicons out. I got everything I could find about this word. I got on Google to find out what people said about this word. And this Greek word, I discovered, means exactly what it says. He appeared in another format. Excuse me. How many of you are old enough to remember LPs and gramophone records? Oh, is it about a dozen of us? We thought that was wonderful. Our parents thought it was wonderful. Our grandparents thought it was miraculous. And all of a sudden, somebody invented the audio tape, the cassette player. And we all went, ooh. But you couldn't play the audio cassette on the gramophone player. The audio cassette had to be played in a cassette player, because when the format changes, everything changes. You can't mix them. And when audio cassettes are going, all of a sudden out comes CDs and CD players. And you can't play a CD on an audio tape cassette player, and you can't play an audio cassette on a CD player. Because everything changes. When the format changes, everything has to change with it for us to use it. And when Jesus came out of the tomb, the format changed. What went in didn't come out. Law went in, grace came out. Flesh went in, but the Spirit of God came out. The old temple system was gone. It was over. It was finished with. It went into the tomb with Jesus. No longer could you sacrifice an animal and shed its blood so that you could approach God, because the Lamb of God had gone into the tomb and had shed his blood for all sin, for all people, for all time. No longer did you have to have a special garment with a special band around your neck. No longer did you have to have a big white hat. No longer did you have to swing the smells and the bells. No longer did you have to, one group could only stand on the outside and watch. That's like the church today. The format changed. The ones on the outside are supposed to be on the inside. And the ones who stand gazing on the outside are supposed to now be the ones doing the ministry. The ones on the platform are supposed to be just the canteen workers feeding you the truth, so that you can go do the stuff. I didn't come into the kingdom of God to watch someone else do it. I came into the kingdom of God with a hunger for God to do it through me. And he has, and he does, and he's still doing it. My God. There's no hierarchy in the kingdom of God. There was in the temple, but when Jesus went into the tomb, it was done away with. It was all over. Israel didn't believe it, so Jesus sent the Romans to finish it and prove it. They dismantled the temple system. They didn't dismantle the temple building. They dismantled the building and every other building and all the systems, and they've never been able to recover to this day. Why? Because Jesus said the format has changed. And when he appeared to Mary outside the tomb. She didn't recognize him. Why? Because he changed. Then she went to grab him. Why? Because she had lost him. She thought she'd lost him forever, that he'd been stolen and she'd never seen him. And when she understood it was Jesus, because he said, Mary. That was the only way she knew it was Jesus. She fell at his feet to grab him, and he went, no. She wanted to not lose him again. See, sometimes you want your security in what you know. The past. My God, if you have your security in the church as it is today, you're going to be really messed up in a few years, because there's a move of God coming, and it's not a revival, it's a reformation. It's a bona fide reformation, and it's in the earth today. It's in the earth today, and it's dismantling stuff. It's setting the captives free, the captives of the church. He's setting every person free to walk in the power of the Spirit as his own son did. God will not be happy because we go to heaven and go, well, I spoke in tongues once. Oh, once I fell over and I felt the power of God. Oh, I led a person to Jesus. Well, I think I did. What will make him happy is if you walk in 100% of what he died for you to walk in. For you to do 100% of what he's empowered you to do. You can drive out every darkness. You can drive out every sin. You can drive out every sickness and disease. You can drive out every devil and demon. You can drive out every confusion that's in the mind of people. And I'm telling you, there's a lot of confused people in America. There's a few in Wales as well. A lot of people are messed up mentally. That's a demonic activity going on all around us that we, the church, shouldn't even have to deal with. We should be so free in our spirit, soul, body, mind, and strength. Thank you, guys. You'd have to buy my book to find it out. But Jesus changed his appearance 7 times. And each time he appeared, they still didn't recognize him. Why would he do that? To mess you up. To stop you putting him in your box. You see, they tried to put him in a box. It was called a tomb. But he just walked out. And he will not let you put him in a tomb now. But when he appeared to those two men on the Emmaus Road, they didn't recognize him. They were debating, is it the end? Is it the beginning? Is it all over? Is something just starting? They didn't know how to handle it. So they were walking away from Jerusalem. They were giving up. And you might have tried to give up. You might be in a place that sometimes you feel, I just want to give up. It's okay. You're about to see Jesus in a way you've never seen him before. Because when you see him in a way you've never seen him before, you suddenly get up out of your despair, up out of your fear, up out of your guilt, up out of your despair. And you will walk in the ways of Jesus all over again. They went in the house. And in the middle of a meal, he took the cup and he took the bread and did exactly what he did in the upper room. He said exactly to them what he said in the upper room. And they were eyes on him thinking, how could this man know what Jesus did? How can this man know what Jesus said? And all of a sudden, the eyes open and they realize it's Jesus and poof, he's gone. When did Jesus ever do that before? You see, he has a nature, and he's trying to show us that we are saved and delivered from an old Adamic nature, and we've been given the Christ-like nature, and it has all the abilities of God. And if we will just yield, you said at the beginning about surrendering. That's the greatest thing we can all do. Surrender our thoughts to think his thoughts. Surrender our eyes to see what he sees. Surrender our ears to only believe and think and speak and hear what he says. Surrender of our mouth to say nothing contrary to the word of God, but only say what he says. Surrendering our body, surrendering our soul, surrendering everything about us so that he can live his life in us and through us and reach a world in a way we could never imagine. Now, I don't know if you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ. Well, let me tell you, I spent 17 years in a Methodist church and I left because I was bored. I thought there's nothing in this. I didn't understand it at all. But on the top of a cliff, when I was about to jump off and kill myself, I heard the audible voice of God. call me. And 7 days later, I was born again. And I want to tell you, he picked me up as if I was as black as tar and dropped me in a bucket of something like bleach, because when I stood up from the ground, I knew I had been totally delivered from every sin, every sickness, every disease, every infirmity. I knew I had no fear. I knew that I had total righteousness. I knew it, and I was yet not even taught one verse from the Bible. I knew that because he showed it to me on that night, because he's alive. And if you're in here today and you don't know that living Jesus, you can get up off your seat right now and come down here. You can come down here and give your life. Surrender it. Surrender it to him right now and find this living Jesus is absolutely greater than anything you've ever known. Are you here? Anyone? Come now. Quick. Quick. Come out. Wherever you are. Amen. Come on, bro. Anyone else? Come on. Receive Jesus and let him live his life in you. You will never, ever be the same again. Anyone? Come on, there's some more. There's some more coming. Amen. 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 Yes. Yeah. Come on. Heaven is shouting right now. Heaven is rejoicing right now. Come on. Is there any more? Come on. Don't listen. Don't listen to your friends. Don't worry about what people think. Just come right now, wherever you are. Come, if you're on the watching on television, watching on live stream, you can do something. You can write in. You can respond right now and say, I am going to give my life to Jesus Christ, and someone will contact you. Here's some more. Look, look, more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He will remove your sin and throw it as far as the east is from the west. Amen. There's more. There's still more. Look at this. Come on. Come on, everyone. Let's rejoice. Let's rejoice. Right. I want you to do something right now. Anybody that's sick in this room, anyone that's sick in this room, put your hand up right now. Put your hand up if you're sick and you want prayer. Put your hands up wherever you are. Come on, stick it up. Put it up high so people around you can see. We're not going to call you forward. The great man of God is not going to lay hands on you, because the man of God called Jesus Christ is living in the person right by the side of you, in front of you, and behind of you. If you can see a hand raised up, turn to the person and lay hands on them right now. Go on. If there's anybody there, if you can see a hand, go to it. Go to it and pray for them. There's people here. Pray for them. Start rebuking and come. Don't ask God to do something. You tell that disease what to do. You tell it to leave its body. As fast as it came in, it can go out. In the name of Jesus, we command every person's body in this room to be a disease-free zone. We declare every disease shriveled up and swallowed up because of the name of Jesus. And we speak the life of Jesus into every single person's body right now. We declare good testimony. Good testimonies. In Jesus' name. For you shall never grow weary. You shall never be tired. You shall never lack for any good thing. For I am with you, says the Lord. I will be with you in the darkest moment and the brightest light. I will be in you where there's no one with you, and I will be with you when everybody's for you. I will be with you, and I will strengthen you that you may go in my name and do what I've called you to do. You will know today, says the Lord, you will know this moment onwards the pulse of the Holy Spirit, and you shall go and do what I've given you to do, and you shall see the signs and the wonders following you. And you will lead people every quarter of this earth. You will lead them into the things of the Spirit, into the things of God. And you shall multiply. You shall multiply and behold the glory of God wherever you go. Father, I bless this church. I speak your life over every single person. I speak your health, your regime of confidence and peace. And I thank you that the grasp, they will grasp, they are the righteousness of God in the land of the living. I thank you. You will rest on this people in a heavy way. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, how many were blessed by that tonight? It's a whole new format. Why don't we all stand before we leave tonight? For those that came up here, your life will never be the same again. You've made a decision to follow Jesus. You've made a decision to give your life to Him. And just as He said, in your surrender, everything will begin to change. Everything is changing right now. How many are excited for those that are giving their life to Jesus tonight? In a moment, we're going to pray for you and we're going to help you take your next step. Your next step is a class called Holy Warriors. And we're going to go through that together. How many are blessed by that word by Wynne Goss? Can we give them a hand of appreciation? Thank you so much. Let's say this together. Let's pray together. Don't forget, if you want to purchase his books, their books are available outside in the foyer. You're going to want to get those. They did not bring crates full, so there's only a few of those left and available, so you want to grab those. But let's bow our heads and let's pray together. Repeat this after me. Say, Jesus, thank you for going to the cross and taking all of my sin and my sinful nature and nailing it to the cross. Thank you for giving me a new nature, a righteous nature, your nature. Thank you, God, for forgiving me and for setting me free. My faith is in you and in you alone. From this moment forward, I will never be the same. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit and use me however you see. Show me your plans, show me your will, and I will live that out. From this moment forward, my life is yours. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Can we give Jesus some praise tonight? Come on, if you receive that word tonight, give God one shout of praise, a shout of praise tonight. Thank you so much, church. We love you. Don't forget, this Friday, we got a car meet outreach. All the men, if you want to go to the men's, real men finish the race, you can see Jerry or Armando up here in the front for some more information. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you this Sunday. We are so excited about what God is doing here at the church. God bless you. If you need prayer, come forward. We would love to pray with you.